Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Loving Someone with Attention Deficit Disorder, a practical guide to understanding your partner, improving your communication, and strengthening your relationship, by Susan Tschudi, M.A., narrated by Kim Niemi. This publication is designed to provide accurate and authoritative information in regard to the subject matter covered. It is sold with the understanding that the publisher is not engaged in rendering psychological, financial, legal, or other professional services. If expert assistance or counseling is needed, the services of a competent professional should be sought. Introduction. In my counseling practice as a licensed marriage and family therapist, I work with couples who are trying to restore broken aspects of their relationships. While not all of the couples have attention deficit disorder, ADHD, as an issue in their relationships, a surprising number of them do. Sometimes they already know it, and other times I pick up on it and assist the couple through the diagnostic process. I have discovered that while it is important to help the partner with ADHD to manage symptoms, it is equally important to address the frustrations and problems that the non-ADHD partner experiences. In fact, sometimes the non-ADHD partner needs counseling more than the ADHD partner does. There is no doubt that it can be difficult to be in a relationship with someone who has ADHD. Although it is not unusual for two people with ADHD to find each other and establish a relationship, the vast majority of people with ADHD end up with a partner who does not have the disorder. I assume that you are listening to this book because you are the partner who doesn't have ADHD. You probably do not struggle with distractibility, impulsiveness, inattention, or restlessness to the degree that it impairs your daily functioning, but your partner probably does. You may be well-versed in the particulars involved with ADHD, or you may not know very much at all about it. Your partner may have received a formal diagnosis, or you may only suspect that ADHD is part of the problem. Regardless of where you and your partner are in the process of understanding ADHD, I trust that this book will be helpful to you in your relational journey. I know what you are going through. On a personal level, I have come to know and understand ADHD well, but this knowledge came about by accident. When I was in graduate school, the only discussion of ADHD occurred in a class that focused on evaluating and conducting therapy with children and adolescents. I spent the required amount of time learning the symptoms and the criteria for diagnosis, but since I knew that child therapy was not going to be my professional focus, I mentally filed the information away and considered it somewhat irrelevant as a diagnostic issue for adults. After completing my education, I began my clinical training in earnest, and during one of my first field placements in Los Angeles, I found myself counseling a very creative population. Most of my clients wanted to work or did indeed work within the entertainment industry as actors, musicians, directors, producers, lighting experts, set designers, and so on. Although I was unaware of it at the time, many people with ADHD are very creative, and I began to discover that many of my intensely creative clients were exhibiting some of the same symptoms of ADHD that I had studied in my graduate school class about children and adolescents. Wrapped up and firmly entrenched in many of my clients' challenges and failures, including past academic pursuits, work-related endeavors, and especially interpersonal relationships, were many of the symptoms attached to ADHD. So I searched for as much information as possible on adult ADHD and attended whatever seminars and workshops on the subject that were available at the time to help me understand and work with this population. As I began to better understand the disorder and how it can affect an adult, I discussed my findings with my husband at home, usually over dinner. Time and time again, he made the comment, "That sounds like me." And I had to agree. I don't remember the specific time or place, but at one given moment, we looked at each other and had a mutual aha experience. That's when the light bulb went on for both of us. Consequently, my husband was evaluated, and the results supported our suspicions. He tested at an appreciable level for the inattentive type of ADHD. He has since found that taking medication has lessened the symptoms and helped him significantly. Even though medication has helped my husband, there are still times when the frustration of dealing with his long-standing symptoms of distractibility, impulsivity, restlessness, and overall inattention just plain gets to me, and I become aggravated, discouraged, and angry. I have become frustrated over the years with the lack of attention paid to the non-ADHD partner and the problems this person experiences while living day-to-day with a partner who has ADHD. The purpose of this book is to share helpful information I have learned about ADHD in my own life and through my clinical practice. Names have been changed and situations modified to protect confidentiality. Just as I struggle to maintain healthy parameters in my personal life, I will encourage you and help you learn to do the same. It can be challenging, but in the end, it's worth all of the effort. What to expect? As the non-ADHD partner, if you lack knowledge about ADHD, you may be unaware of the far-reaching and sometimes detrimental impact this disorder has on relationships. You may feel discouraged and helpless to affect any change. In both my personal and professional lives, I am dedicated to supporting and helping partners to sustain healthy relationships. Therefore, each part of this book is devoted to helping you to learn more about ADHD and to discover healthier, more productive ways to survive the ups and downs of a relationship that involves ADHD. In Part 1, Help, My Partner Has ADHD, we will examine what ADHD is and what it isn't, including a description of the different types of ADHD and a discussion about what causes this disorder. Part 2, Understanding Your Partner, focuses on the impact of ADHD and how the disorder affects your partner in every area of life. Just as important, Part 2 will also help you to understand how your partner's ADHD affects your life, too. Part 3, Strengthening Your Relationship, examines solutions and skills that can help you navigate your daily life with your ADHD partner in a healthier and more constructive manner. Let me be clear. This book is not a 30-minute guide to understanding your ADHD partner. I wish it were that simple, but it's much more complicated than that, as you probably already know. You are invited to enter into a realistic and deeper understanding of both yourself and your ADHD partner, which takes courage, resiliency, and resolve. I look forward to sharing this journey with you. Part 1. Help! My Partner Has ADHD. Chapter 1. What ADHD is and what it isn't. The problem with ADHD as a disorder is that no one can see it. It isn't as obvious as the debilitating symptoms of depression. Depression often displays itself with sadness, lack of energy, isolation, and sleep and appetite disturbances. Also, ADHD isn't as obvious as the agitated behavior that can be associated with pure anxiety, such as excessive worry and nervousness. The basic behavioral markers generally connected to ADHD are restlessness, impulsivity, and distractibility. These characteristics play out in an adult's life as forgetfulness, difficulty sustaining attention, loss of focus, lack of follow-through, procrastination, fidgeting, impulsive speech and behavior, poor time management, moodiness, and so on. For people who don't understand ADHD, the behaviors resulting from adult ADHD can appear to be issues of character, selfishness, self-centeredness, laziness, and disrespect. Chronic and unchanging, these behaviors add to the impression of a lack of personal integrity, especially as it relates to an intimate relationship. In Karen and Bob's home, they divided up household duties equally, and it was Bob's job to take out the kitchen trash when the container was full. Karen didn't mind so much that Bob never seemed to realize that the bin was full and needed emptying, but she did begin to take offense when, after constant reminders, the trash still didn't get emptied. After a while, she began to believe that Bob was exhibiting passive-aggressive behavior by ignoring her on purpose. The truth was that Bob had ADHD and tended to get distracted by something while on his way to pick up the trash can. He would get involved in whatever caught his eye, and the trash would be forgotten. Although there are some exceptions, the perception that the behavior of a person with ADHD stems from selfishness or self-centeredness is generally untrue. If a client with ADHD is habitually late to our counseling session, I know not to assign any ulterior motive to her behavior. She is not, by nature, rude or inconsiderate. In fact, she probably had every intention to be on time. So I must remind myself that this client has ADHD, and because of that, and that alone, something most likely distracted her and time got away. By examining what causes ADHD, you will realize that ADHD is not a character issue at all, but a disorder with solid neurobiological origins. What causes ADHD? Let's get a basic understanding of what ADHD is, according to the experts who study it. Attention deficit / hyperactivity disorder, or ADHD, is a neurobiological disorder that results in underfunctioning of specific areas of the brain. Certain neurotransmitters in the brain, called dopamine and norepinephrine, are not dispersed in an even manner, which causes the brain to underfunction. Dopamine is responsible for attention, focus, and staying on task, while norepinephrine assists with attention span, impulsivity, and distractibility. The underfunctioning seems to occur primarily in the area of the brain called the prefrontal cortex, which is located right behind the forehead. The overall function of the prefrontal cortex is to assist in self-management. The brain's ability to self-manage is commonly referred to as executive functioning, and it is in charge of the following crucial functions: attention span, judgment, decision-making, planning, prioritizing, impulse control, modulation of emotions. To put it simply, the purpose of executive functioning is to help us sort through all the different possibilities of action that crowd into the brain. Then, executive functioning helps us to make good decisions or choose the best action or behavior according to the circumstances. Furthermore, it also helps us to set, work toward, and complete goals and objectives. Picture an executive sitting at a big desk and imagine all of the tasks that are necessary for getting a job done. Making decisions, giving directives, managing employees, setting goals, overseeing different departments, and directing outcomes. The ADHD symptoms of forgetfulness, difficulty with managing time, procrastination, disorganization, poor follow-through, impulsivity, and distractibility create unusual demands on executive functioning and hinder its ability to work properly, resulting in diminished ability to pay attention, make decisions, exercise judgment, and so on. The capacity to manage all of the tasks at once is compromised, and the natural flow of executive functioning is disrupted. When this part of the brain underfunctions, behaviors caused by ADHD become more evident and, in some cases, problematic. While everyone struggles with feeling restless, being distracted, and acting impulsively from time to time, A diagnosis of ADHD is given when these symptoms create some type of impairment in a person's life. Impairment in life touches on personal, social, and occupational areas. It's not uncommon for adults with ADHD to experience issues such as chronic unemployment, job hopping, or workplace difficulties. They also might have problems with accomplishing life goals and difficulties with maintaining meaningful relationships with friends and partners. Types of attention deficit disorder. ADD or ADHD. There is a common misconception that there are two separate labels for this disorder. I have heard many people say, "I have ADD, I don't have hyperactivity, so I don't have the H." To clear up any confusion, both terms refer to the same condition. ADHD is the accurate term for anyone who has the disorder, and that is the term that I will use throughout the book. However, the clinical diagnosis of ADHD is subcategorized into three different subtypes, all three of which are classified as attention deficit / hyperactivity disorder. But there are different markers that create each subtype. Let's discuss each in turn. ADHD, predominantly hyperactive, impulsive type. The first type of ADHD is called attention deficit / hyperactivity disorder, predominantly hyperactive, impulsive type. The following are common symptoms of hyperactivity based on the Diagnostic and Statistical Manual of Mental Disorders, 4th edition text revision, DSM-4-TR, and the Adult ADHD Self-Report Scale Symptom Checklist. Feeling overactive or acting as if driven by a motor. Frequently feeling restless or fidgety. Talking too much. Frequently fidgeting or squirming, especially using your hands or feet when you are required to sit for long periods. Frequently leaving your seat when you are expected to remain seated. Frequently having trouble relaxing during free time. The following are common symptoms of impulsivity based on the previously mentioned DSM-4-TR and the Adult ADHD Self-Report Scale Symptom Checklist. Frequently finishing others' sentences. Frequently interrupting others when they are trying to focus on other activities. Having frequent difficulty awaiting your turn. The predominantly hyperactive impulsive type is what the general public most often recognizes as ADHD. The classic image is of a kid, usually a boy, who can't sit still in class, bothers his classmates by interrupting them, talks out of turn, makes lots of careless mistakes, and is constantly reprimanded by the teacher. Hyperactivity in adults is rare, although it does exist in some people. I remember counseling a male client with predominantly hyperactive, impulsive type ADHD who was physically incapable of sitting on my couch for the duration of an hour-long session. He would stand up, pace, and even crouch down on the floor occasionally. A few times he asked if we could conduct our therapy session outside while walking around the parking lot because he felt so restless and wanted to move. As a child grows into adulthood, we see fewer of the overt antics connected to hyperactivity because the hyperactivity tends to morph into a feeling of tension or generalized restlessness. Most adults are able to moderate their hyperactivity, yet whenever I observe a person in my counseling room toe-tapping, knee-jiggling, or swinging a crossed leg, I suspect that I am observing adult hyperactivity. After I notice this behavior, I gently point it out and ask my client if he is nervous or anxious. Without exception, if the person turns out to have ADHD, he denies being anxious and adds that he was completely unaware of what he was doing. Suddenly self-conscious of the behavior, he immediately stops the bouncing or jiggling, but before too long, it starts up again. Another diagnostic tool in my office is one of those expandable grid plastic toys sitting on a table. If, during an initial session with a client, she picks it up and starts playing with it, that's also a clue that this might be another version of adult hyperactivity. I then begin taking a more detailed history that might lead to an undiscovered diagnosis of ADHD. ADHD predominantly inattentive type. The second type of ADHD is attention deficit slash hyperactivity disorder predominantly inattentive type. The common symptoms of this type of ADHD, based on the DSM-4-TR and the Adult ADHD Self-Report Scale Symptom Checklist, are as follows. Having trouble concentrating on what people say to you, even when they are speaking directly to you. Having problems remembering appointments or obligations. Frequently misplacing or having trouble finding things at home or work. Frequently avoiding or delaying getting started on tasks requiring lots of thought. Having trouble setting things in order for a task requiring organization. Having trouble paying attention when doing boring or repetitive work. Getting easily distracted by other activities or noises. Making careless mistakes on boring or difficult projects. Having trouble completing the final details of a project. The person with the predominantly inattentive type of ADHD doesn't demonstrate any hyperactivity or restlessness, at least on the outside. I don't observe much toe-tapping or knee-jiggling in this type of ADHD. In fact, the person with inattentive ADHD can sit still for long periods. But he tends to struggle with what I call an inner fidgetiness, and he experiences restlessness internally. A female client with the predominantly inattentive type of ADHD once told me that she felt as if her brain were filled with television sets, all tuned to different channels and all turned up to be as loud as possible. A casual observer would be hard put to understand this about her, because this woman appeared to be calm and collected. But her internal struggle was pure hell for her. The inattentive type does not display very much impulsivity in word or behavior. Unlike her hyperactive impulsive counterpart, she normally does not interrupt, speak out of turn, or butt into conversations. This person has probably never been told, "Be quiet and sit down." The inattentive type is more likely to be called a space cadet, or maybe asked, "Hello, is anyone in there?" Because a person with this type of ADHD tends to get lost in thought and daydream a lot. To others, the person with inattentive ADHD appears to have checked out or to be mentally stuck in one place. This person is more likely to be labeled as lazy because she tends to be rather slow-moving. She doesn't jump right into things. One might not expect the symptoms of inattentive ADHD to cause problems, especially compared to the restless and impulsive behavior associated with the hyperactive impulsive type. But if someone is rather sluggish or slow-moving, as well as inattentive, distractible, and forgetful, this person might have chronic problems with procrastination and poor follow-through. As a result, the person with inattentive ADHD may seem to be unmotivated, unconcerned, uncaring, and nonchalant. The behavior that results from this type of ADHD is just as likely to be attributed to a lack of character. The predominantly inattentive type of ADHD is seen most often in females and generally is not detected as early, primarily because kids with this type of ADHD don't cause any trouble in school. They are not disruptive. But when the school curriculum in the 7th or 8th grade gets more stringent, demanding more and more attention to detail, these kids tend to hit the wall academically and start to falter. Consequently, a child with inattentive ADHD, who previously may have been a pretty good student, starts to have academic struggles due to the fact that the schoolwork gets more tedious and boring. Remember all of those English lit novels where it takes 30 pages for someone to say hello to another person? Or how about memorizing historical facts relevant to the American Revolution? While all of this can be hard enough for most people, it feels nearly impossible for someone with the inattentive type of ADHD. When a child with undetected and undiagnosed inattentive ADHD starts to fail academically, not much consideration is given to the possibility that the cause might be ADHD. Because the symptoms of inattentive ADHD are less disruptive and don't cause any problems for others, this type tends to go under the radar. Most adults who are diagnosed with ADHD predominantly inattentive type are surprised that they have ADHD. Monica. I have what? Monica, a 30-something-year-old woman, said in our third counseling session. She initially decided to seek counseling out of frustration with her personal life and complained that she couldn't get anything done. Monica's history was fairly common for someone with inattentive ADHD. She said that she had been a good student in grade school, but had sort of lost her steam by the time she reached high school, and had some academic challenges that resulted in poor grades. She was well-liked, had friends, and didn't have any problematic behaviors that got her into trouble. Monica enjoyed her current job, which allowed her to move at her own pace and to interact with others. But she had been let go from her previous two jobs because she couldn't keep up with production goals. Monica's home life was problematic for her. She complained that she just couldn't get a handle on things. She was disorganized, with stacks of papers everywhere and piles of things all around. Plus, she said she wasn't able to stay on a task for very long, especially a detailed one, no matter how hard she tried. She was behind on her taxes and had lots of late charges because she kept forgetting to pay her bills on time. Monica felt that she was somehow incompetent and unable to live a productive life, and she had a general sense of feeling less than others. She was surprised at my suggestion that she might have ADHD, because she thought that ADHD looked like that boy Timmy in my fifth grade class who would never sit still, talked a lot, and got in trouble all the time. Once I explained to her what inattentive ADHD was and how it affected her life, she was very relieved. "Wow, at least I now have a name for it," was her initial response. Previously, without any understanding that her struggles were due to the neurobiological impairment ADHD causes, Monica had just tried to manage as best she could. She longed for a life that felt more personally satisfying and rewarding, but had come to think of it as an impossible goal due to her belief that there was something wrong with her. When she discovered that ADHD was at the core of her struggles, she felt renewed hope for the future. By the time an adult gets diagnosed with inattentive ADHD, he, like Monica, has usually formed some pretty strong personal beliefs that sound something like, "I'm not smart. I'm dumb. I could do so much better if only I tried harder. There must be something wrong with me, and I'm just bad." Even with the new realization that ADHD has caused most of these problems, such negative beliefs can be hard to dispute because they have existed for so long and have been reinforced along the way by parents, teachers, bosses, and even partners. ADHD combined type. We tend to think of ADHD in simple terms. A person has either the hyperactive impulsive type or the inattentive type. Although the two types might seem to be incompatible due to the differences in behavioral symptoms, the third type, attention deficit / hyperactivity disorder combined type, is a combination of the other two types. Research has shown that the combined type of ADHD is much more prevalent than one might think. The person who fits the combined type of ADHD has symptoms that match the hyperactive impulsive descriptors listed and symptoms that match the inattentive descriptors listed. Therefore, such a person will demonstrate both inattentive and hyperactive impulsive behaviors. A person with ADHD combined type will at times have the space cadet tendency of the inattentive type, but will also demonstrate the restlessness and impulsivity of the hyperactive, impulsive type. Leslie, who has ADHD combined type, would often space out in our couples counseling sessions, and it was obvious to both me and her husband that her attention had wandered off. She would get very quiet and focus on something in the room or on a part of her clothing, for example. Her frustrated husband would impatiently ask if she had heard anything he had said. Her body would literally jump as if she had received a small electrical jolt as her attention was pulled back into the room. She would say, "Huh? What? Oh yeah, I heard you," when it was obvious that she had been in her own world. Leslie was definitely inattentive in our sessions, but outside of our sessions, she displayed a considerable amount of restlessness and impulsivity that was consistent with the hyperactive, impulsive type. She was constantly starting projects at home and then leaving them unfinished, all over the place. She hated housework with a passion, so she would procrastinate about doing the dishes or cleaning the bathrooms, and then find any reason at all to leave it all behind, get in her car, and go somewhere else. Somewhere else usually tended to be the mall, and although she wasn't extravagant, she had a big shopping problem that involved buying all kinds of unnecessary, but fun and colorful, things. Regardless of the type of ADHD, the problematic issues surrounding the symptoms are basically the same: a general inability to pay attention for an extended period to the more mundane and ordinary things of this world, a restlessness, physical or mental or both, that makes it hard to sit still and pay attention, the tendency to get distracted by something less important and stray off target, and difficulty in thinking things through before acting on them. The dilemma of diagnosing. It can be difficult to properly assess an adult with ADHD, primarily because for many years it was thought that the disorder affected only children and that they would outgrow it and not be affected by it as adults. The DSM-4-TR provides the diagnostic criteria for ADHD that are used for all ages, but the descriptors are fundamentally related to ADHD in children. Dr. Thomas J. Spencer, a psychiatrist who is an expert on ADHD, aptly describes adult ADHD as an orphan diagnosis, because so many clinicians are not trained to recognize it in adults and tend to ignore it, trivialize the symptoms, or miss it altogether. We now know that adult ADHD is alive and well, as research shows that around 4% of the adult population is affected. Adults do suffer from ADHD, but most find ways to work around the disorder because the symptoms tend to be more varied and subtle in adults. While some ADHD behaviors are easier to notice in a school setting, sitting in a classroom all day can be very difficult for a child with ADHD, most adults with ADHD avoid anything that approximates their school experience, opting instead to work in occupations or take on endeavors that allow for some variety. The majority of my adult clients with ADHD excel in jobs where there is some sort of stimulation in the work environment. There are exceptions, but I don't know many people with ADHD who have chosen occupational pursuits like bookkeeping, engineering, or library science, for example. As a result of the fact that ADHD was regarded for so many years as a childhood disorder, most of the questionnaires, checklists, and so on that clinicians often use to diagnose ADHD were originally created and designed for children, and little has been done to change that. The adult manifestation of ADHD seems to have been an afterthought in the mental health community. Consequently, most of the diagnostic measures may not get an accurate assessment or a good enough read for a proper ADHD diagnosis. As a result, the diagnosing clinician may miss the diagnosis and determine that the adult doesn't have ADHD. If you and your partner decide that a further investigation of ADHD might be necessary, here are some things to keep in mind. Don't make a definitive conclusion about ADHD just by filling out a self-test questionnaire you find online or in a book. While filling out a quick and easy checklist may be useful for pointing you in the right direction, it is just a starting place. Find a clinician who believes that ADHD exists, understands how it can manifest in adults, will take the time to ask lots of questions about current problems, and will take a complete history. Accompany your partner to the evaluation and, if appropriate, to ongoing appointments. Your input as the non-ADHD partner is valuable. What about medication? It's not unusual for adults who receive an ADHD diagnosis to have little, if any, understanding of the medications that are used to treat the disorder. For example, why medications are recommended, what types of medication are used, how they work, who is the best person to prescribe medication, and so on. In addition to this lack of information, there is also a great deal of misinformation among the general public, leading to negative opinions regarding using medication for ADHD. Since medication can be a crucial component of effective treatment, misinformation or lack of information can create barriers to getting appropriate help and ultimately to obtaining a better quality of life. Therefore, it is important to have a general understanding of medication for ADHD. Why take medication? Medication has proven to be an effective component of the treatment of ADHD. Medication can assist with the ability to pay attention, stay on task, and refrain from acting out impulsively. In my clinical practice, I have noticed that when a client takes the proper medication at the appropriate dose, she is better equipped to actively participate in her relationship with her partner. She can pay attention, respond appropriately, assume responsibilities, and follow through with greater ease. My client Karen, mentioned earlier, reported that after her husband Bob began taking medication for his ADHD, she noticed that he consistently remembered to take out the trash without any reminders, nagging, from her. And she stated that she felt better about their relationship overall. Her husband was perplexed. He didn't understand how taking out the trash could have such a strong impact. But I explained to him that his showing consistency in small areas helped relieve his wife of feeling bothered, which enabled her to concentrate on more positive aspects of their relationship. Types of medication. The following are types of medication commonly prescribed for ADHD symptoms. Stimulants. The most common is stimulant medication. Stimulants are quick and predictable, with few side effects. They are the first-line treatment for adults with ADHD, which means that a stimulant is usually the first medication considered, because stimulants have been found to be effective at reducing the core symptoms of ADHD by targeting the under-functioning of certain neurotransmitters in the brain. The trade names for the most common stimulant medications marketed are Ritalin, methylphenidate hydrochloride, and Adderall, dextroamphetamine and amphetamine. While both drugs target the neurotransmitters in the brain, each has its own unique delivery system. As a result, a person may have better results with one or the other. I have had some clients who reported no reduction in symptoms when taking one stimulant, but after switching to another, experienced a noticeable and significant difference. Because stimulant medications are fast-acting, results are usually noticed within a relatively short time. If the medication is working effectively, the person should feel more focused, generally more productive at everyday tasks, and more engaged in what's going on in the immediate environment. If the medication is not working because it is the wrong medication or the dose isn't high enough to be effective, the person won't feel different.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.